Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God, you hate nothing you have made, and forgive the sins of all who are offended. Create and make in us new and contrite hearts, that we, worthily lamenting our sins and acknowledging our wretchedness, may obtain of you, the God of all mercy, perfect remission and forgiveness, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Shout out, do not hold back. Lift up your voice like a trumpet. Announce to my people their rebellion, to the house of Jacob their sins. Yet day after day they seek me and delight to know my ways, as if they were a nation that practiced righteousness and did not forsake the ordinance of their God. They ask of me righteous judgments. They delight to draw near to God. Why do we fast, but you do not see? Why humble ourselves, but you do not notice? Look, you serve your own interest on your fast day and oppress all your workers. Look, you fast only to quarrel and to fight, and to strike with a wicked fist. Such fasting as you do today will not make your voice heard on high. Is such the fast that I choose, a day to humble myself? Is it to bow down the head like a bulrush, and to lie in sackcloth and ashes? Will you call this a fast, a day acceptable to the Lord? Is not this the fast that I choose, to loose the bonds of injustice and to undo the thongs of the yoke, to let the oppressed go free and to break every yoke? Is it not to share your bread with the hungry and bring the homeless poor into your house? When you see the naked, to cover them, and not to hide yourself from your own kin, then your light shall break forth like the dawn, and your healing shall spring up quickly. Your vindicator shall go before you. The glory of the Lord shall be your rear guard. Then you shall call, and the Lord will answer. You shall cry for help, and he will say, "Here I am." If you remove the yoke from among you, the pointing of the finger, the speaking of evil, if you offer your food to the hungry and satisfy the needs of the afflicted, then your light shall rise in the darkness, and your gloom be like the noonday. The Lord will guide you continually and satisfy your needs in parched places and make your bones strong. You shall be like a watered garden, like a spring of water whose waters never fail. Your ancient ruins shall be rebuilt. You shall raise up the foundations of many generations. You shall be called the repairer of the breach, the restorer of streets to live in. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Now let us read responsively from Psalm 103. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is forgives all your sins and heals all your infirmities. He redeems your life from the grave and crowns you with mercy and loving kindness. He satisfies you with good things, and your youth is renewed like an eagle's. The Lord executes righteousness and judgment for all who are oppressed. He made his ways known to Moses and his works to the children of Israel. The Lord is full of compassion and mercy, slow to anger and of great kindness. He will not always accuse us, nor will he keep his anger forever.
He has not dealt with us according to our sins, nor rewarded us according to our wickedness.
For as the heavens are high above the earth, so is his great mercy upon those who fear him.
As far as the east is from the west, so far as he removed our sins from us.
As a father cares for his children, so does the Lord care for those who fear him.
For he himself knows whereof we are made. He remembers that we are like dust.
Our days are like the grass. We flourish like a flower of the field.
Second reading is from 2 Corinthians. We entreat you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. For our sake he made him to be sin, who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. As we work together with him, we urge you also not to accept the grace of God in vain. For he said, at an acceptable time I have listened to you, and on a day of salvation I have helped you. See, now is the acceptable time. See, now is the day of salvation. We are putting no obstacle in anyone's way, so that no fault may be found with our ministry. But as servants of God, we have commended ourselves in every way. Through great endurance, in afflictions, hardships, calamities, beatings, imprisonments, riots, labors, sleepless nights, hunger, by purity, knowledge, patience, kindness, holiness, right hand and for the left, in spirit, holiness and spirit, genuine love, truthful speech, and the power of God, with the weapons of righteousness for the right hand and for the left, in honor and dishonor, in ill repute and good repute. We are treated as impostors, and yet are true. As unknown, and yet we are well known. As dying at sea, we are alive. As punished and yet not killed. As sorrowful, yet always rejoicing. As poor, yet making many rich. As having nothing, and yet possessing everything. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus said, "Beware of practicing your piety before others in order to be seen by them, for then you have no reward from your Father in heaven. So whenever you give alms, do not sound a trumpet before you, as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and in the streets, so that they may be praised by others. Truly, I tell you, they have received their reward. But when you give alms, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, so that your alms may be done in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you. And whenever you pray, do not be like the hypocrites, for they love to stand and pray in the synagogues and at the street corners, so that they may be seen by others. Truly, I tell you, they have received their reward. But whenever you pray, go into your room and shut the door and pray to your Father who is in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you. And whenever you fast, do not look dismal like the hypocrites, for they disfigure their faces as to show others that they are fasting. Truly, I tell you, they have received their reward. But when you fast, put oil on your head and wash your face, so that your fasting may be seen not by others, but by your Father who is in secret. And your Father who sees in secret will reward you. Do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moth and rust consume and where thieves break in and steal, but store up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust consumes and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord.
Gracious and loving God, may only your words be spoken. May only your words be heard. Amen.
Amen.
Please be seated. Something's shifted. Change, it's palpable. Today, we are confronted with language that is quite different than what we are used to and with which we are the most comfortable. Today we speak of lamenting sin, of acknowledging our wretchedness. What happened? Why such a shift? In the very earliest days of the church, those seeking baptism and those hoping for reconciliation with the church would cover themselves with ashes. And they would wear sackcloth, ashes on their face, in their hair, under their nails, getting in their eyes. The sackcloth around them, coarse and itchy, uncomfortable. Jesus in the wilderness, no sense of direction in the desert, out of place, no order to things. Unsure where his next meal was to come from, not knowing what challenge weather was going to bring next. No bathing, no change of clothes, no mat to lie on or pillow on which to rest his head. Uncomfortable. Christians mark this day, the first of the 40 days of Lent, with the imposition of ashes on our foreheads. Brittle, dry palms from previous years' Palm Sunday celebrations are burnt and then crushed into ash. We will come forward and have these ashes rubbed, indeed
imposed on our foreheads. Just about every Ash Wednesday, I have a similar experience. I receive my ashes and leave the church. While I am acutely aware of the ashes initially, inevitably the moment comes while I have forgotten that they were there. They'll itch a little, and I will, without thinking like I just did, wipe my forehead with my hand, removing most, if not all, evidence. My body knows that something is not right. It's uncomfortable. Becoming intentionally uncomfortable. That is what today is about. Today we begin a season when we are invited to leave behind what is known and predictable and comfortable and walk with Jesus into the wilderness to practice becoming uncomfortable. And I believe that is what God is calling us to do. I believe that God calls us to be uncomfortable. Because, friends, I believe that God is uncomfortable. I believe that when God sees whole countries starving while others feast, or here in the wealthiest country in the world, that there is need even for something called a food pantry or a soup kitchen, God is uncomfortable. I believe that when God hears the cries of those whose loved ones are murdered by war in Palestine, in Israel, in the Ukraine, in Myanmar, or the Sudan, or in this country by gun violence or addiction, God is uncomfortable. I believe that when God sees vestibules of ATMs serving as housing for the unhoused, and that those escaping violence in their home countries used as political pawns in an election cycle, God is extremely uncomfortable. And God begs us to be uncomfortable with these things too. Evelyn Underhill wrote at the beginning of the last century, quote, "No Christian escapes a taste of the wilderness on the way to the promised land. And the wilderness confronts this generation in a very harsh and concrete form." End quote. Powerful words at the time they were spoken, equally powerful for us today. No Christian escapes a taste of the wilderness on the way to the promised land. What I appreciate about Underhill's insight is how matter-of-factly she speaks of the wilderness. If we are Christians, and if we believe in the possibility of transformation, then what we hear and see and experience in this world in which we live must make us uncomfortable. The wilderness discomfort that God calls us into involves taking a good look around at ourselves, at our relationships, at our communities, and at the world in which we live. This wilderness forces us to ask uncomfortable questions. This is sharing with God in God's discomfort. It is accepting God's invitation to walk with God into the wilderness. In a little bit, we will be invited into the observance of a Holy Lent. In this prayer, we are given some tools for living in the wilderness. We are invited each Lent to practice self-examination, repentance, prayer, fasting, self-denial, and reading and meditating on God's holy word. These are not easy tools. They might even make you uncomfortable. And that's precisely the point. Lent provides an opportunity for us to acknowledge that the wilderness is actually a sacred part of our journey as followers of Jesus Christ. It is a necessary part, a productive part of our lives of faith. For without the wilderness, we do not become uncomfortable. Without becoming uncomfortable, we do not desire change. Without a longing for change, we are unable to share in bringing about God's long-desired plan for us and for the rest of the world that God has created. But friends, the wilderness is not the end. It is not even the goal. The wilderness is not the place where we are meant to stay. No one in the history of the church has ever had to receive ashes on Ash Wednesday or enter the wilderness of Lent without the promise of Easter waiting on the other end. We can enter Lent today with assuredness and hope because we know the promise that waits for us just 40 days from tonight. For we are ultimately a people of the resurrection, or should I say, resurrections, many resurrections from many crosses that stand waiting at the end of many wildernesses, and many wildernesses that each begin with the decision to get, if only for a short while, just a little bit uncomfortable. Again, tonight we begin again our journey through the wilderness to the promised land of the empty tomb. So, friends, welcome to the wilderness, and please make yourselves uncomfortable. Amen.
I invite you to stand as you are able. Dear people of God, the first Christians observed with great devotion the days of our Lord's Passion and Resurrection, and it became the custom of the Church to prepare for them by a season of penitence and fasting. This season of Lent provided a time in which converts to the faith were prepared for holy baptism. It was also a time when those who, because of notorious sins, had been separated from the body of the faithful, were reconciled by penitence and forgiveness, and restored to the fellowship of the Church. Thereby, the whole congregation was put in mind of the message of pardon and absolution set forth in the Gospel of our Savior, and of the need which all Christians continually have to renew their repentance and faith. I invite you, therefore, in the name of the Church, to the observance of a holy Lent, by self-examination and repentance, by prayer, fasting, and self-denial, and by reading and meditating on God's holy word, and to make a right beginning of repentance, and as a mark of our mortal nature, let us now kneel before the Lord, our Maker and Redeemer. Almighty God, you have created us out of the dust of the earth. Grant that we may take seriously to heart our mortality and penitence. And remember that it is only by your gracious gift that we are given everlasting life. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior.
Amen. pray Psalm 51 together. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your own kindness.
In your great compassion, blot out my transgressions. Wash me through with my iniquities, and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions, and my sin is ever before me. Against you only have I sinned, and done what is evil in your sight. And so you are justified in what you speak, and upright in your judgment. Indeed, I am wicked from my birth, a sinner from my mother's womb. For me, the whole look for truth deep within me, and will make me understand the presence of his good. Purge me from my sin, and I shall be pure. Wash me, and I shall be clean indeed. Make me hear of joy in the hearts, that the body and the broken we rejoice.
Most holy and merciful Father,
we confess to you and to one another, and to the whole community of saints in heaven and on earth, that we have sinned by our own faults, in thought, word, and deed, and by what we have done, and by what we have left undone.
We have not loved you with our whole heart and mind and strength. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We have not forgiven others as we have been forgiven.
Have mercy on us, Lord.
We have been deaf to your call to serve as Christ served us. We have not been true to the mind of Christ. We have grieved your Holy Spirit.
Have mercy on us, Lord.
We confess to you, Lord, all our past unfaithfulness, the pride, hypocrisy, and impatience of our lives.
We confess to you, Lord,
our self-indulgent appetites and ways and our exploitation of other people.
We confess to you, Lord,
our anger at our own frustration and our envy of those more fortunate than ourselves.
We confess to you, Lord,
our intemperate love of worldly goods and comforts and our dishonesty in daily life and work.
We confess to you, Lord,
our negligence in prayer and worship and our failure to commend the faith that is in us.
We confess to you, Lord.
Accept our repentance, Lord, for the wrongs we have done, for our blindness to human need and suffering, and our indifference to injustice and cruelty.
Accept our repentance, Lord.
For all false judgments, for uncharitable thoughts toward our neighbors, and for our prejudice and contempt toward those who differ from us.
Accept our repentance, Lord.
For our waste and pollution of your creation, and our lack of concern for those who come after us.
Accept our repentance, Lord.
Restore us, good Lord, and let your anger depart from us.
Favorably hear us, for your mercy is great.
Accomplish in us the work of your salvation. By the cross and passion of your Son, our Lord.
Bring us to all saints to enjoy his resurrection.
Almighty God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who desires not the death of sinners, but rather that they may turn from their wickedness and live, has given power and commandment to his ministers to declare and pronounce to his people, being penitent, the absolution and remission of their sins. He pardons and absolves all those who truly repent and with sincere hearts believe his holy gospel. Therefore, we beseech him to grant us true repentance and his Holy Spirit, that those things may please him which we do on this day, and that the rest of our life hereafter may be pure and holy, so that at the last we may come to his eternal joy. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Beloved in Christ, the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Let us greet one another with the sign of Christ's peace. Please be seated. Are there announcements? Just checking. My name is Bishop. Oh, yes, please. Bishop Mello, I am your Bishop Diocesan, and it is a great privilege to be here with you on this Ash Wednesday night to celebrate with you. One of the things they warn you about when you become bishop is that you will miss the rhythm and flow of parish life, and so I am so grateful for you bringing me under your wing into your parish to have this moment in your life with you, so thank you. Do not neglect to do good and to share what you have with one another, especially your love, for these are the sacrifices that are pleasing to God.
Thank you.
us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who was tempted in every way as we are, yet did not sin. By his grace we are able to triumph over every evil, and to live no longer for ourselves alone, but for him who died for us and rose again. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy,
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 holy Lord,
God of power and might,
heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love you made us for yourself. And when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you, in your mercy, sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. And we celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit, to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him, and with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our
Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast.
These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Thank you. us pray. Almighty God, you have given your only Son to be for us both a sacrifice for sin and also an example of godly life. Give us grace that we may always most thankfully receive these spiritual gifts and also daily endeavor to follow the blessed steps of his most holy life through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Bow before the Lord. Grant, most merciful Lord, to your faithful people pardon and peace, that they may be cleansed from all their sins and serve you with a quiet mind, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.